So welcome to this webinar that is dedicated today to the French Geological Reference Platform, that is so-called in French RGF, standing for Référentiel Géologique de la France. It is a national program involving the academic community, and it can be seen as a step forward complementing the geological maps and including a three-dimensional ambition as well. Today we have two voices from BRGM, the French Geological Survey. We have with us Thierry Baudin, who is a geologist. Thierry is the scientific coordinator of the RGF, and he was in charge of the Pyrenees work program that is one of the last focus area in the scope of this RGF national program. And the second speaker today is Maxime Padel, a real geologist as well. And you already know him because he's a part of our geological mapping and modeling expert group within the Eurogeo surveys. And in particular, Maxime works on the event geological maps that will be presented in the second half of the webinar this afternoon. So, Thierry.
I'm going to share my presentation. You see, it's okay now?
Yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Thierry Baudin. I'm a structural geologist and I work at BRGM for over 25 years. And I've also started my long career now, made or participate to the realization of about 30 geological maps in France and Switzerland and Morocco too. And 14 years, as said Philippe, I've been also well involved in the designing and the building of the RGF program. And this is this program that we are going to present to you today with Max. RGF means in French, Référentiel Géologique de la France. I'm not sure of the English translation, but we could call RGF the Geological Reference Framework of France. And I have a problem. Doesn't work. Okay. You can see the slides?
Yes, that's okay.
Okay. The RGF is thus the new program which follows the previous program of the geological map of France at the scale of 150,000. And this program ended in the 2010s. And it was a real institution that involved about 3,000 geologists from academia and BRGM too, about 1,030 geological maps have been produced in totality. And today the works on the field are all completed, but a few maps still have to be published. And you can see on this slide that the most of the production of French geological map was done between the end of the 60s and the end of the 90s. And in this period, the geological map was the indicator of the geological knowledge of an area. Indeed, the geological research on the French territory accompanied the geological mapping up to the 90s. And at this time, a lot of PhD works were funded by this geological map program. And on the right here, you can see Do you hear me?
Yes, Thierry, we can hear you.
Okay. You can see here on this slide the number of academic collaborators, which is decreasing with the end of the production of the geological maps. There were still nearly 160 collaborators here in 1995, and only two or three remain since the 2010s. And so, when this mapping program was finishing, we had to think about what to do next. And many of our managers considered that once the program was over, we had to move on. And the maps had to be enough on their own. And obviously, the geological community did not agree with this point of view, and we wanted a new program more suited to the needs of the 21st century. And we therefore carried out critical analysis on the geological map according to the new geological needs and to better meet the subsoil users. And indeed, today geologists are asked to make more and more 3D geological models to do digital simulation. And here you see two examples of the 3D geological models in which permeability is introduced to simulate groundwater flow here or water circulation in a karstic aquifer. And another example here, where we need to introduce thermal conductivity of rocks for geothermal simulations. And sometimes we need to couple also permeability and conductivity to simulate thermal upwelling along faults. And in terms of seismic risk, it's the same. The seismic wave velocities can be introduced into the 3D models to simulate earthquakes, and sometimes the 3D geological model is used to identify the active faults thanks to the representation of the seismic focus. Okay. All of you know these modelization works as well as we do, and you also know that making a 3D geological models takes a lot of time, and we have to spend too much time for collecting and homogenizing the data and making them consistent. And we therefore had to overcome these problems to improve the 3D model production line. And it's not a question of making 3D models everywhere, but organizing the data to make models more quickly when necessary, and above all, to capitalize on these data. So we start by doing the critical analysis of geological maps, and we obviously found that they are, first of all, very heterogeneous among themselves. There are many geometric inconsistency on their boundary, and the same formation may not have the same name from one to another one. And generally, the point data are too little represented. And moreover, the maps stay frozen in their publication state. And it is very difficult and expensive to update it. And this means that all the new data or the new interpretations which are after the map publication couldn't be integrated. And this is a problem because the map no longer restitutes the geological knowledge state of a region. And furthermore, there is no information on the geological interpretations and even on the different events that led to the current state of the rocks. And the last, but not the least, there is no links between the drill holes and the geological maps. So we had thus to consider that the current geological maps all the borehole sets are therefore not suitable for producing routine 3D models or even the coherent data sets. The RGF was thus designed to try to overcome all these obstacles. And the essential task is then to make the data consistent and to eliminate as much as possible the geometric inconsistencies between the map limits. And we want to move in future toward the grid unification of the geological data. We want to ensure data consistency to be able to establish correlations or interpolations between data from different sources. And this data come from the geological map, the shallow or deep drilling, the seismic profiles or geophysical data, such as magnetism or gravimetry. And considering the huge amount of data, you realize that the RGF is really a long-term program, which could probably take 2 or 3 decades of work. And to ensure consistency, homogeneity, and continuity of all of these data, we must assign the unique code to each geological unit. Whether there are geological formations or structures as faults, for instance. And this is why we need to establish lexicons, a kind of reference frameworks for lithostratigraphy and geological structures. In French, we call référentiel these different frameworks. And we also created a reference framework dedicated to geological events because the geological interpretations or concepts are also fundamental in the 3D model buildings. And Max will take to you more precisely about these referentials and the RGF methodology. And obviously, we cannot process all these data at the same time and on the wall of the French territory. And this is why we have chosen to work by a geological region. In 2014, we built the RGF demonstrator here in the Vosges and Rhine Graben. And then we work on the Pyrenees chain and its foreland from 2014 to 2019. And since 2019, we have started 2 major projects. The first in the Alps and its foreland basins, and the second in the Paris basin here. And as the same for the geological map program, the RGF program is very federative and collaborative too between the BRGM actors and the academic community. And we can see here the number of PhD and masters which have been involved in this regional project. And on the example of the Pyrenees RGF project, which is over now, we have got 13 PhDs, 34 master's students, 33 publications, and 50 conference presentations. And just to sum up now, I will just to show you the RGF geological data flow. And you can see at the top of the slide here the BRGM activities, which consist in making the data consistent whether there are from the geological map, boreholes, field data analysis, geophysicals. And all this leads to the creation of four lexicon here, the reference frameworks for lithostratigraphy, structures, events, and chronostratigraphy. And all these lexicon are managed in geological information systems with all the analytic data, and all these informations should be now used to build 3D models. And you can see also that the RGF academic collaboration or even other projects are also providing new data. And finally, when a region is considered as geologically coherent, as it's the case for the Pyrenees, all the data and especially the reference frameworks will must be then validated by the RGF scientific committee before to be disseminated outside. And you see here the website links. And however, you have to know that this information system is still under development. And it's taken much longer than we thought, and we are still having some fun.
Fisheries conservation and.
Sorry, I have a. May I continue?
Yeah, I think you can now, Thierry. That's okay.
Okay. This system of formations taking much longer than we thought, and we are still having from difficulties for getting it up and running. So you see, contrary to the geological map program, when the regional RGF project will be completed, it will be then able to integrate all new data coming from the different academic or other sources. And we can also modify the maps or 3D models into the RGF information systems. Okay. I finished. I let Max continue the talk. He's going to present the methodology that was used in the RGF Pyrenees project. And the event geological map. Max, if you.
Yes, thank you. Let me share my screen. Do you see my screen here?
Oui, Max, c'est bon.
Okay, so I put my presentation. Do you see the presentation?
Oui, yes.
Yes, oui. Okay. So thank you, Thierry. So I will now present you the event geological approach that we developed at the BRGM with one example of this approach on the Pyrenees. So as a geologist, I almost born in the Pyrenees because I made my PhD during this RGF program. So I will try to explain you what I've made after my PhD here in the BRGM to transform the geological map to a new era of 2.0 concept. So, as already said, Thierry, I just made a quick synthesis to be more focused on the Pyrenees. So in 2013, in France, marked the end of the French geological mapping at 150,000 scale, and the launch of the RGF, so French geological reference system or reference platform or reference framework. We still don't know which word we have to use in English because in France it's référentiel, which is a noun, and référentiel in English it's an adjective. So it's maybe just a semantic problem, but we still don't know which name to use in English. Well, anyway, so. The launch of the RGF program starts with on the Pyrenean belt. In the Pyrenees, you have about 59 geological maps that have been made between the 16th and up to now. So one of the objectives of the RGF is to restore a continuous and a coherent layer of geological knowledge on the whole territory. So you can see here on this image the different date of publication of the map. And here you have the same patchwork with the geological maps. So the first thing that you can notice is you have some problem of correlation or some incoherence or some problem of harmonization between some maps, and that's the first step that you have to deal with. Okay, so. Okay, do you hear me? Oh.
Yes, Max.
Yes, we can.
Okay. I think I have a problem with my PowerPoint. It's not the first time. The PowerPoint just crashed down. Oh, fantastic. Wait. Okay. Can you see?
Yes.
Right. So you didn't see that I have a problem, but I had one. So I have to go. No, it's okay. So one of the finalities of the RGF is to provide, as Thierry said, a 3D representation of the geological history. So to do that, you have from one side drilling and a geological map that give you information on basically on lithostratigraphic and structural geology. And from the other side, you have explanatory notes, you have publication, PhD, that give you the geological history. So the issue, as already mentioned Thierry, is the heterogeneity of the map made at the different times. So there is no link between borehole and maps, almost no point data on the map, meaning that you have point data, but they are not on the GIS program. The state of the knowledge is frozen at the date of the publication of the map. So if you want to make a homogenization of the map, you have to take a map from the 16 and map from now and try to make them to talk about. And you have no traceability of the data. So the idea is to rely on new technology to build a reference system, whether they are lithostratigraphic or structural, or here, geological event reference system. And use databases to link to the geometry, and with the objective to homogenize and harmonize geological knowledge, to make all type of data compatible with the development of a 3D model. So the idea is not directly to build up a 3D model of the Pyrenees, but make the data consistent and make it possible to do this 3D models of the geological history. Okay, so this is how it works with a picture here that shows you the data model, where you have at the base factual data organized in databases with field work for field interpretation or observation. You have data from laboratory analysis, structural measure, or paleontologic analysis. So this is the factual data. Then you have a second level of data, which are interpreted data, meaning that you use some statistical tool to get a first interpretation of your data. Like when you do some geochronology, you have some punctual analysis on zircon, and then you use a statistical tool to estimate the age of your samples. So this interpreted data helps you to build up your models, whether they are lithostratigraphic or structural. So this lithostratigraphic and structural data registered in what you call reference system. So this reference system are hierarchized, and you have, for example, here the lithostratigraphic reference system and the structural reference system, which are in fact the knowledge databases. And all these data are linked to the chronostratigraphic reference system. And as Thierry said, this chronostratigraphic reference system is in fact the international chronostratigraphic chart with some local and regional aspect and specificity for local, lithostratigraphic layer, which are important to keep but to make it consistent with this international system. So here is what you have, factual information databases and knowledge databases. And the idea is to link all this data together. So now, in the Pyrenees, the first step was to build the lithostratigraphic reference system from supergroup to formation member. So I don't know if you remember, there was this map of the Pyrenees where you have a patchwork of information. So what we made is to make consistent all the geological information of this lithostratigraphic reference system at the different scale, at the different ranks, but at the same scale, the 150,000 scale. So on the lithostratigraphic reference system, you have from supergroup to member, ID, a name, a rank, an age, a description. You have the lithological content, so the first lithology and the second, etc. Thickness of this lithostratigraphic unit, all the reference that you use to justify the models that you enter in this lithostratigraphic reference system, and the symbology that you associated to this, so the color, for example. So all of this allow to draw a map at this different rank with information and 150 scales, So this hierarchized and harmonized lithostratigraphy map is a starting point to realize the event map, because before thinking about have a map that talk about history or geological history, you have to think to have a map that talk about classical lithostratigraphic geology. However, there are several data linked to the geological history which are not included in the lithostratigraphic reference system, of course. So you have, for example, data on metamorphism and weathering that you can find on the map. You have actually some polygons that give you information about the metamorphism, about the contact metamorphy or the radial metamorphy, about the weathering here. You have data from explanatory notes like tectonometamorphic evolution or paleogeographic reconstruction, and from publication, where you can have, for example, the geochronological data. So these different data make it possible to characterize the different geological events. What is so now, if I take these data models and what do I have here? I have this event reference system together with structural zone reconstruction and the paleogeographic domain affiliation. This reference system, you see, this event reference system compile all the geological models, including the lithostratigraphic models. Okay, I will explain you later why, but inside this event reference system, you include the first lithostratigraphic model that you have on the map, because it's the starting point for your different geological model. So here we are. Next, so what is a geological event? We can define it as any natural process giving birth to a geological object or responsible for any transformation of it. So the first event we can distinguish in a rock is its own birth. So corresponding to this genesis, for example, you have a sedimentary event, sedimentary deposit of this clayton, is the genesis of these rocks. Then the evolution of these rocks results from all the transformation events since its genesis. So for each step of its evolution, you're going to have some transformation event, like tectonometamorphic event or weathering events. And all these events will transform your rock. So your geological units are characterized by a complex history due to the superposition of geological event draft time. So when classical map favors a representation of an event over the other, for example, your map will represent that you have an orthognathous, not that you had granite, or you have a mica schist, not that you had a claystone. The goal is here to provide different map across time to see these different events. Okay. Now, in the same way as lithostratigraphic reference system or structural reference system, so geological event reference system consists of hierarchize three of the geological events. So the first rank, rank 0 to 2, correspond to geodynamic events. So you have here Wilson cycle. Inside the Wilson cycle, you have divergence and convergence phase. And inside this divergence and convergence phase, which are large scale, you have more regional phase or local phase, transitory phase, etc. These are all the geodynamic events that will support the more the event at small scale. So these small scale events start with at rank 3, where you have a large sedimentary, like sedimentary basin filling, or magmatic, volcanic or plutonic, or tectonometamorphic, climatic, and weathering episodes. At rank 4 to rank 6 here, you have the small scale geological event. In fact, they correspond to the smallest geological object that you can represent on the map. It's the equivalent of a member or formation for a map at 150,000 scale. Now, with this new approach, you can link all the geological events to your geological unit. So if you have an orthogonase, polygons, his polygons will contain the whole geological history that you have suffered. And you have a K-map here, or legend. It's made up boxes containing the entire geological history. And this K-map can evolve over the time. So you're going to have different K-map for at different time. Now, polygons, polylines, point data, like measure, analysis, all are linked to the geological event reference system. The goal is here to provide different map from event 1 to event 4. Event 1 to event 4, 6, 7, 8. So this is not a multi-layer approach. So we don't have different shape with different shape for each geological event. We have one single shape, so we're just one polygons from this map, and he will carry out all the event information as a sequence of events. So with this geological event approach, now we'll talk to you about the point data. With the geological event approach, you have different data can be linked to each other. What does it mean? So you go to the field work, you take a sample, and measure from the field can be linked to laboratory analysis. All this data, so field data, field from samples, field from sin section, or PT path, or geochronology, whatever, they are capitalized in different databases. And they can be associated to the same event. So that's the idea, to make all the data linked with this event. Okay, now what about the drill? What about the 3D dimension? So how to propose a geological event information in 3D? So from geological maps, you have a classical lithostratigraphical information. So, for example, here, I have a facies model, deposito facies model. You will extract from the field a lithostratigraphic model, formation A, B, C, and you will draw your limit facies. And from the drill, you can have access to sequential stratigraphic information, meaning a timeline. Okay, so as the same way as you build facies limit, you can build time limit of the different regressive and transgressive cycle and show on the map here the sediment which were deposited at the same time. So that can just one example with the stratigraphic sequence, sequence stratigraphy, but you can use it for any kind of purpose, like for metamorphic or weathering profile. The idea is to allow to have a 3D information that is coherent between the map and between the borehole. In this case, it can be used for, I don't know, like paleoplacer. If you have some gold in conglomerates, you want to know if this gold go on this paleoplacer further on the basin, and you can trace this paleoplacer with this time limit. on the sandstone and then on the mudstone. Well, now, as you know, you can have different geological interpretation for a set of data. So here, the proposition is to, so I called it geological data linked to various geological interpretation models, because you can have you can have different geological interpretation for a data set. So we propose it to allow to represent these different models on the geological map. So I will show you one real example we have in the Eastern Pyrenees on the Canigou Gneiss. So it's from my, nearly from my PhD. So the Canigou Gneiss is on the Pyrenees, on the axial zone here, on Eastern Pyrenees. So the Canigou is this body in, what I would say, orange or pink, whatever. So the lithostratigraphic model that you found on the map built before 1985 is that this Canigou Gneiss is a pre-Cambrian basement overlapped by Ediacarian and Cambrian sediment. And this model is applied everywhere in the Pyrenees. So everywhere where you are going to have this orthognathus before 1985, the idea was to say that it's a pre-Cambrian basement overlapped by Ediacarian and Cambrian sediment. Because this sediment, at the first order, there was like a paraconform, like, I don't know how to say that, it was almost stratigraphically conform to this gneiss. And in fact, recent data have allowed to show that this magmatic event linked to the genesis of the protolith of this gneiss was ordovician, and then followed by a tectonometamorphic event during the variscant orogenesis make this first model obsolete. And the first aspect that you go on the film and the idea is that this sequence of Ediacarian and Cambrian sediment are almost paraconform to this gneiss is because they are completely deformed. So you have an intense deformation that make your formation layered by the deformation with some schistosity oscillation. Okay. So a quick synthesis for this geological event approach. Oh, here it's a little bit complicated, but I will show you that the idea of this picture is to say that at each step, for example, point databases, lithostratigraphic or structural reference system that help to build up your geological event reference system for each step of this different databases, you can build some maps. And these maps are all linked to the geological event reference system. So the idea is to have an update, a 3D harmonized geometry, and to provide a document, to propose a document coherent with the geological models. And the finality is not only for geology, I mean, it's not only we say research or just the geological aspect, but it's for any applied geology. For example, here we made some example on asbestos occurrences. You can mix different criteria to show the impact of the event for these occurrences, and it can be for field movement or something like that. Well, we can talk about it later, but it's not just for geology, even if it's important. But so what is the result on the Pyrenees? I'll show you on map. But first one, I have to show you how we did that. In the Pyrenees, we have been able to hierarchize 3,400 events in the access databases, where each of them have an ID here, a parent here, a type, so intrusive or tectonometamorphic, sedimentary deposits, etc. A description, an age, a publication reference, etc. So you take the ID and you put it on the polygon, and where you want to represent the geological event, And you build a sequence of geological events where the sequence, in fact, is a sum of these geological events experienced by the rocks in question. Okay, just to illustrate this seven geological map, in the Pyrenees, we will represent the last stage of the Variscan convergence, where you have several types of events at the permo-carboniferous transition. So this is from Conchelin et al., so a PhD made during this RGF. So this data have been integrated directly in the geological event reference system. So the last stage of the Variscan convergence, it starts with a high temperature, low pressure tectonometamorphic event. So it's not my specialty. So if I say something wrong, Thierry, please correct me. So this event is associated to a different metamorphic zone, chloride, biotite, or some partial melting rocks, and some orthognathes, like the Canigou orthognathes. This metamorphic event is followed by a calco-alkaline magmatism expressed here in purple, with contact metamorphism in green. And this has been studied by Lemire et al. In the RGF, during the RGF in the Pyrenees. Now, if I make a zoom on the Eastern Pyrenees, you can show these two events, so the calcoalkaline plutonism and the tectonometamorphism event together, to better understand the repartition. And finally, the last event is expressed by a transpressive deformation located in Milanitic shear zone here and associated with foliation that can be represented on the final map to illustrate the model of Cochlin et al. So all these data are on the databases that is linked to this reference system. So just to the pleasure, I will show you a quick overview of this geological event map from the Ediacaran to the Carboniferous. We start with the Pan-African cycle, where you found some back arc basin on the Eastern Pyrenees, linked to the Cadomian convergence. This is the sediment that was overlapping the Canigou orthognathes, which is in fact intruded by him. It's followed by Cambrian deposit, deposit on passive margin along the North Gondwana plate from basin. Then you have the sardic phase with sardic magmatism, where you found this Canigou granite for the portolite. It's followed by Silurian deposit, then Devonian, and Saint Convergent basin with Carboniferous deposit, the Kulm basin, and then the story that I've told you earlier. Okay, so the main objective of this approach is a realization of a complete database containing the entire geological history related to geometry, whatever map, drilling, section, 3D models, point data, etc. The objective was to develop a new and innovative approach allowing to organize the geological data. So the geological reference system, the geological event reference system, become the link between the different databases because it carry out the geological history. And this approach allows to link the reference system to map and to subsurface geometry to produce a geological map and document suitable for different geological models. And of course, to identify poorly constrained zones where you have to go back to the field to complete the information. And to propose a predictive and complementary approach for geoscience district plan. Okay, so thank you very much. If you have questions, you're welcome. I go back.
Thank you, Maxime, and thank you, Thierry, for this presentation regarding the RGF. So it's time for questions. You can either raise your hand or if you don't find the right button, you can start to speak. We have a question from Yarmo. So please, Yarmo, you're muted for now. Yep.
Yeah, thanks, Maxime. It was very, very interesting. I didn't get really the idea. Wait a minute, I have a look. you said. Wait. You said that. Just a moment. I cannot find them. Anyway, basically the question is that you have different kind of features. You have polygons and you have structural lines, and they are divided in two different databases. Okay, you have structures and you have the stratigraphic units. Correct.
Yes.
And then you bring in these events. So do you link the event as an attribute to all the features you have in your database, or how you make the connection between the events and the features, the map features, the lines and polygons?
Yeah, basically what you have is on your database. Maybe I can show you. I can go back to this. I don't know if it's useful, but just to illustrate. Okay. Do you see that? Still not yet.
Not yet.
Okay. Sorry. I will just get my screen. Now you see that?
Yes.
Yes, it's coming.
But if I well understand the question, is how you make the link between this, the reference system, the event reference system, and all of this data. That's your question?
Yes, my question was that how I understand the map features. You have structures and you have the units, the stratigraphic units or any geological units, and then you bring in the concept of events, and those events are progressing time-wise. And how do you link those map features to these events? Because many of the features can represent several events.
Yes.
And the events, let's say metamorphic fronts, can cross-cut the lithostratigraphic units.
Yes.
How can you manage these things?
Yeah, there is two ways to do it, and we have experienced the two different ways to do it. So it's a bit technical, but when I talk about sequences, it's because the first way that we made it is we have built this event reference system in the access databases. So each event have its own ID, and for each lithostratigraphic, lithostratigraphic unit where you're going to have a different geological history, you build a sequence of this different event that you want to add it in the shape. So you put the ID of this sequence that is built up of this different event, where each event has its own ID. You take this ID and you add it in the map for the polygons where you want to show this different event. And the other way to do it is not to build up a sequence on the access basis, but directly on the map, on the shape. You organize your shape with this table, and on the table for your polygons, you had the different ID of the event you want to represent. And it can be made on the same way for structure or for point, because each structure or point can have his own table with this ID. And from in front of the ID of this polygons or this structure or the point, you will have the ID of the event you want to show. And at the end, because this ID is linked to the on the databases is linked to this hierarchized structure. If you want to go to rank 0 to rank 1, just ask to show from this ID, show me the upper rank, like for example the Pan-African level, etc., etc. There is different way to do it. It's a technological issue, and this is the most delicate point, because we have to work on it to make it more efficient. And I think that the first the first step that we made to build up sequence on the database and then to take this number to go on the map take too much time. So it's better to go directly on the map and indicate from each polygon how many events you have suffered. I don't know if I answer your question.
Okay, I think I mainly got your point, but now I found it. You say here in one slide that with this new approach, we can link all the geological events to the geological unit. Okay, I understand. Mm-hmm. But then you say that polygons contains the whole geological history.
Yeah.
So what confuses me is that are you linking them really to units or are you linking them to, in the database to the unit or in spatial system to the polygon?
To the polygons.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So you have one unit gonna have several polygons, and each polygons gonna have his own geological history. For example, you talk about metamorphism.
Okay.
You can have a claystone that's gonna have two events of metamorphism, contact metamorphic and regional metamorphism. And from the other side, you're gonna have a polygon of the same unit. They're gonna have only one event, which is the metamorphic, the regional metamorphism. And you just say, okay, this one have one event of metamorphism, and the other one has the two events of metamorphism.
Okay. Okay, thanks very much. I would like to see this in action, but I hope I understood. And we can discuss this more later if you have time sometimes. Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, and the next question is from Zoltan.
Thank you. Can you hear me? I think okay. So first, I express my appreciation. Really excellent work, Maxim. Excellent work, really. I was very glad to see it because just yesterday we were discussing with Hans Georg, and also tomorrow it will be a matter of our extraordinary meeting of expert group of geological mapping and modeling. I will present very short lecture there concerning methodology of designation and distinguishing lithotectonic units. As you know, we have subtasks about lithotectonic units. We have distinguished some areas in Europe where this will be exemplary distinguished and shown, visualized. And seeing your lecture, so I was pleased that really you mentioned, for example, tectonic metamorphism and designated as M2 metamorphic phase, but the D2 deformation phase. It's completely the same like we have in our approach. And my suggestion will be presented tomorrow. For example, transpressive events, shear zone and so on, is D3. And my suggestion or our maybe agreed methodology of lithotectonic unit will be done by this way, that we strictly take into account orogenic cycles and orogenic phases. And more or less all orogenic phase cycles have the same, have divergence, riftogenous phase, then convergence, subduction, collision, and so on, tectonometamorphic events. And this designation of D1, D2, D3, D4 is the same for all. And we have also added prefixes, and this exactly express which orogenic cycles, it's Caledonian, Variscan, Alpine, and so on. So I think that we are in very good road now because we are thinking the same and using the same methodology. So I think it will be applicable for the whole Europe, really.
Good to hear.
And concerning a previous question that polygons express complete geological history, yes. Also, in our methodology, which will be presented tomorrow, it is meant by this way, that we will have polygon, we will have sequence of these abbreviations that will be, for example, VD1, Variscan, compressional phase, subduction and collision. Then there will be metamorphic or complex, it will be VD2, Variscan, tectonometamorphism and deformation. And next will be, for example, AD1, Alpine opposite virgin thrusting, for example. So excellent. Once more, appreciation for my side. Thanks.
I have to mention it, it's not only my work. Huh? It's, there is many people working on it. And just here because I just want to present it. But...
Thank you, Zoltan, for the comment. And the next question is with Esther.
Hello, and thank you for the presentation. It's a very interesting one. I just have one question about the polygons and the shape of the polygons. So because there are deformation events in geological history changing the form and the shape of geological units, for example, folding or pressure or something like that. Do you take that in account and how? So is this information somehow stored in the database? Because I think the shape is not changing, isn't it?
That was a discussion I have with my colleagues on this image, because this concept I show you the geological evolution, but what you have at the end is this one.
Yes.
And the shape of your orthognathus is not this one, is this one. So now you don't make a restoration of the tectonic event. You don't make a structural restoration, or you just add the event for this unit. And what you can do, if you have the information from the map, for example, this orthognathus is covered by a sediment here. If you know that here you can make polygons when you say beneath this sediment, I know that I have orthognathus. Okay, so you're gonna add that on this polygon beneath it you have the orthognathus, but you don't make a restoration of the shape of the different body before the deformation. In fact, this picture, we did change it because it was not very. It doesn't express exactly what we want to, what we do, because you don't have restoration. You use the polygons what you have, and you tell its history, but you don't go further.
Yeah.
And if you want to make
Yeah, I think that became clear when you showed the example of the Pyrenees. The question was only, is this a possibility to store the information how it looked like before? Like, okay, it is now folded, but before that it was like an hexagon or something like that?
We did have this question in a congress. When people are really interesting in the, what was the shape of the body before the deformation. But the information that we have is information from the map. And the information from the map don't give this restoration. So we could eventually we could talk about it. We could talk about how to restore the shape of this kind of rocks. But I don't think the map will be the place to do it. I think it's something different. The reconstruction is something different. But you can put the information that this polygons was linked to an event, and earlier it has this shape. Okay, you can do it. But going further, that will be another interpretation of the geological event, which is already an interpretation of the geological data.
Okay. So,
thank you. You're welcome. Thank you. Before coming to you, Hans-Georg, just to let you know that there are also some questions and answers in the chat. There is one that is not yet answered. So it's about the approach you presented, Maxime. And is it only dedicated to let's say 2D geological structures? Polygons on the map, or is it also dedicated to linear structure like faults and so on?
Yes, you can use it for linear structure. You can use it for fault, and if you have a line structure, you can also add a geological event information. No problem with this.
Okay, Hans-Georg, please.
Okay, thank you. I suppose what you call tectonostratigraphic unit is what we call lithotectonic unit in our work package 6 application for the coordination support action. And in your approach, you clearly demonstrated that you start with lithostratigraphic maps, and that you indicate the polygons with additional information from events, and by this way you create lithotectonic or tectonostratigraphic units. But there is not yet visible if there is also something like a registry for these tectonostratigraphic units with definitions and so on. Is this the case, or is this coming in future, that there is also a kind of knowledge base or registry for these larger units?
Yeah, it's do you see that?
Yes.
It's what I talked briefly here, is a structural zone reconstruction or lithostratigraphic unit or paleogeographic domain affiliation. This is a discussion that we have actually, because what we want to provide is maps where you're going to have the possibility to show the structural models that you have on your map. The idea is this structural zone reconstruction and the paleographic domains derived directly from the structural reference and the geological event reference system. I mean, derived, it's even like a mathematical relationship, because it comes from it. It's an interpretation of the interpretation. And we are actually in a work in progress on this aspect, to understand how to build up these domains and these lithostratigraphic units.
Okay, so you will be able to also show tectonostratigraphic units or lithotectonic units as polygons.
Yes, that's the idea.
Okay.
In fact, the end is like the event. You're going to have a model of lithostratigraphic or lithotectonic units.
Yeah.
This lithotectonic unit from the smallest scale to the largest scale, for example, if I take this picture, I will say, okay, at the largest scale, I have a southern zone, I have a northern zone and axial zone. So this is the largest lithotectonic unit. When I go deeper to these units, I'm going to have some variscan units and I'm going to have some alpine units. Yeah. And for each polygons, where you have the boss, you're going to say, okay, this have a variscan unit, and this is a, I don't know, if this is a Canigou variscan unit, but it's also a Aspre alpine unit, and you add the information inside the polygon. It's going to be the same way as for the geological event.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Christine, you raised your hand.
Oui, the classic one. Well, I think I wrote it in the chat already. This is, very impressive and highly interesting. And I think we can use a lot for work package 6 for our task 2 out of this, not only for the lithotectonic units. My question is there some sort of connection with the INSPIRE data specifications? Could you use them?
Yeah.
Is there a link to them? Are you feeding your data into the INSPIRE data specifications? How do you do this? Did you use geological event environment and event process? Those? Yeah, well, this is what I would be interested in.
The idea was just to precise, we have a reference system, and inside this reference system, you have lexical, lexical. And this lexical are close to INSPIRE or Geoscience CML, because the idea was to make this data model compatible with this European system.
Yeah.
What we go just further for the event, because we there is some way that we wanted to show this event, but we do integrate the notion of environment process or this kind of thing that you have inside the GeoCML data model. And we did work with Florence Cagnard is geologists that worked that work on this geological event approach know about this because she was working on different group about GeoSCML. So she was like our mind to guide us on this GeoSCML experience. So we try to be the closeness to this data model.
Mm-hmm.
I hope. I mean, I'm sure it's compatible with Inspire. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. Merci.
Thank you. And we have another question from Yamo in the chat. It is still about the link between the events. So are these events linked to polygons or to, let's say, conceptual geological units or both? Because if it's only linked to the polygons, how can you manage the scalability on the map?
Mm. Okay. It will depend of the geologist that will fill the database is what you want to show. I would say to be more if you want to be the more pragmatic and precise, I would say that you only have to add information that you know on your polygons because it's linked to data that you have taken from the field. And if you want to enlarge this information to other polygons that is not directly linked to the rocks or to this event, it's more it's more prospective and it's more that this is, for example, what we can do for tectonostratigraphic reconstruction or paleogeographic domain reconstruction. And this is more about that than about the event. The event, you will try to just focus on the rocks that you want to represent and not go further than the rocks that you want to talk about. I don't know if I'm clear, but it's because the question is...
Yamo, maybe if you want to comment on that or if you're happy with the answer.
Okay, thanks very much. If you think that we make this... In, let's say in 1 to 50,000 scale, this kind of system, and then we go further, let's say 1 to 5,000 scale, and we of course there appear new polygons, and the original polygon splits in many pieces, and we can also have 3D features beneath the surface, which all are sharing the same event features. So I'm just wondering if we are really linking those to spatial features which are dependent on the scale, it might be the option to link them to the conceptual feature called geological unit, which is independent to the scale. Can you get my point?
So it
might be easier to advance with the scalability if it's not directly linked to a geometrical object, but it's linked like a conceptual feature which can have different expressions and different scales. Can you, Maxine, can you see what I'm trying to say?
I think so, but Thierry, maybe Thierry can answer. I think I know what you want to say, but... I mean, the scale is different. For example, for lithostratigraphic, the scale will be linked to the rank because the group will be more at scale bigger, etc. So, and it will be the same for the level. So it's more linked to the concept than to the object that you want to represent. But I don't know, Thierry, if you want to answer.
No. Maybe Yamo, your question is about when you change the scale on the map, you want to know if you lose the link with the event or not. Is it like that?
It's like technical thing. I mean that it's easier to link the if we have one big polygon and in more detailed scale we split it in 55 polygons and there are other features in between. Because it's more detailed work, so in a case if we link the events and other such things to the to the uh, to the formation, I mean the geological unit, you don't need to change everything in your spatial expression. You just create a link to the database. And in general, I have certain doubts about using so much spatial connections between units, because we have features which are cross-cutting each other, which are not in both in space and time. And if we are trying to do more sophisticated models where we can manage all these features independently, I have a fear that these polygons may be a problem, and this approach with spatial features may become a problem in long run.
For the moment, what we do is go ahead, Jim.
Okay, I think the it's not a problem for us. The events are completely independent of the polygon and the geometry. In fact, all the geologists are used to think with GIS, and we made here a true information system. And in this information system, the map and the drill holes too are only a representation of our lexicon. And so the event is also a concept, and the for us the geometry in fact is completely independent. It's only a representation, and this is also a problem. But the event is contained in the geological unit. And this geological unit, in other way, is represented on the map, but it's not exactly the same. We have the concept of a geological unit, which is linked with an event, and for us, the map is is only a representation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So the point. Yeah. So Yarmo, I think that the point is that one is the events are linked to what you call the conceptual units, and then the events are linked to the polygons via these units.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. They are actually not directly linked to the polygons, but they're linked to the units which form the polygons. And there is a difference between
the polygon. In fact, is a property of geological unit.
Okay, I think it should be.
Yeah, thank you. So I think it almost time to come to the conclusion of this webinar. Hans-Georg, you want to add something?
Yeah, maybe a very last question of completely different topic. You clearly explained that there are of course discontinuities between maps of different ages. And is there any systematic approach if and how to invest field work to do the harmonization, or is that completely up, for example, to the academic domain of the project if they do so or not?
I will let Thierry answer that. I would love to go back to the field to fulfill the information of at the limit of the map, but not political, but it's a decision inside the BRGM to say the importance of make it consistent between maps. But as a geologist, I would say we have to do it, and I would like to go there maybe tomorrow. But then from a practical point of view, you have to wait for opportunities that give you the possibility to go there. So it can be from the BRGM, or it can be from academic, but Thierry will answer that.
So no systematic approach how to do it, or there are no resources foreseen to do it in any systematic way?
No.
Okay.
We know today that there will be no more systematic fieldwork, and to do a geological map, except if there is a specific request from a region. But this is why the goal of the RGF is also to create a platform to allow to all the community to be able to store and share the new data. And because we know that it's more and more difficult to go on field. And we try to do that with the regional approach with the RGF, but it's more and more difficult because now it's only applied geology, which we do now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, Philippe, for organizing the session and to all of you who contributed. Finally, as the experts group chair, I want to say a big thank you in the name of all of us. It was very, very interesting. Thank you to your efforts.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the presentation, and thank you all of you for your participation and attention. And I think it will lead to promising discussion within our expert group. So see you soon, and the presentation will be available on the EGS website for replay quite soon. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. And see some of you tomorrow.
Bye-bye. Thank you.